I'd like to introduce my co-chair, the esteemed Maria Glover, a senior scientist from Vidrill Mycobacterium Reference Laboratory. And my name is Taryn Crichton. I'm from the Mycobacterium Reference Laboratory in New South Wales. Anything you'd like to say?
Yeah,
and we'll just want to introduce our first speaker today. If we could invite up Richard Bradbury. Richard is a senior lecturer at Federation University. His areas of research interests include diagnostics in epidemiology in medical parasitology and zoonoses. He is the former team lead of the Parasitic Diseases Diagnostic Reference Laboratory at the CDC in the United States. And he's also a member of two World Health Organization Diagnostic Technical Advisory Groups on Neglected Tropical Diseases. So we're very lucky to have him here today. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Take it away.
I better put on the timer because I get a bit excited and have a habit of running over time. So you can get a shepherd's crook and pull me off if you like, if I'm running over. Now let's hope we can get these slides up and see if we can, I don't know if it's going to work. It's happening. Cool. Ah, there we go. Right.
Can everyone at the back hear me? Because I hate microphones.
Of course, we've got virtual audiences. I apologise. Sorry about that, virtual audience. All right, so let's talk about this. I got asked to give a talk about fecal parasitology, and I thought, oh, golly, shit, what am I going to talk about? I thought, look, why don't I talk about artifacts and weird things that you might come across and how to work out whether it's a parasite or not. So I decided to title it Sorting the Parasites from the Crap. I don't know if that's... Where do I point this to make it work? I don't know. Seems not to be... Yeah, point it up the back. Yep, okay, there we go. That's got it. Have we gone too far? Where am I pointing? That way? Where should I... Up the back. Okay. Now I'm going way too fast. Let's make it work. Okay. No luck. Yeah, let's do it. Yep. Okay. So here are some parasites. These are parasites. Most of these, some of them you'll know, some of them you won't. My marker doesn't seem to be working either. So on the top left, you can see that's a Schistosoma guineensis, which is actually a human parasite found in the Guinea coast region of West Africa. They're very large. They're about 180 micrometers long. And next to that, there's an unfertilized Ascaris lumbricoides. And next to that, there's a pretty basic Trichuris. And underneath, there's a diantamoeba, or a binucleate diantamoeba trophozoite. And you can see two iodamoebas there and a blastocystis. And in the bottom left, there's a entamoeba chatinai pilecki. How do I know it's chatinai pilecki and not another entamoeba? Because of the size of the nucleus to the cytoplasm. The nucleus cytoplasmic ratio tells you that it's in the pilecki group. But that one's actually from a monkey, so it's a chatinai. Now, here's some non-parasites. And yet some of them look a bit like parasites. So the top left, you've got what's probably a yeast or something. It's just a modified acid fast thing in a modified acid fast stain. Underneath that, there's a mite. And this is just an example where somebody did their business on a palm leaf or something and then handed it in to us, and there were mites on the palm leaf. So we found a mite in their feces. Now, next to it, you can see a pollen grain, and then there's that thing looks somewhat like a funny looking Trichuris egg. And I've seen these, I remember seeing these once someone had stored them and said, oh, it's a Trichuris, and we think they were given antihelmintics and it got funny. No, it's actually a pollen. That's a type of pollen. But man, it looks like a Trichuris, doesn't it? And then you've got rotifers and meloidogynes we'll talk a bit about and various other things. So these are all not parasites, but they look a bit like parasites. So I don't know if I can get... Oh, yep. Now I've gone blank. So how do I tell these apart? When I get something strange, how do I know if it's a parasite or not? Well, the first and most important thing is in parasitology, size matters, right? Doesn't in many things, but it does in parasitology. So you absolutely have to measure the size of it because you can get things really look like a parasite, but if they're not the right size for the parasite you think they are, then they're not that parasite. So the first thing I always advise people to do is measure the size. Most parasite eggs are symmetrical. Now, there are exceptions to that, like Enterobius on the bottom right of that picture there. But the vast majority of them are symmetrical. They tend to have defined borders. So you can see most of these ones here have lovely defined borders. In the middle there, I don't know, this marker, there you go. That is a Macrocanthorhynchus egg. That is, they're thorny headed worms, the Acanthocephala. So back when you were at university, helminths were probably nematodes, trematodes, and cestodes. Well, there's a fourth group, the Acanthocephala, and they do infect humans. And Moniliformis and Macrocanthorhynchus infect humans, and that's an egg of a Macrocanthorhynchus. In fact, I've seen a Macrocanthorhynchus ingens in a kid from Texas. But even though it's not got defined borders, you can see it's got a sort of fuzzy edge. If you look at the top ends, you can see that there is a more defined border to part of that. Now, they tend to have quite thin cell walls. When you see plant material, they tend to have quite thick cell walls, or they're not defined. So the edges are not defined. And they have distinct organelles within them. So if you look at these, most of them, you can see there are distinct organelles. Even that Macrocanthorhynchus egg, which is probably the most difficult to differentiate as being a parasite, at each end at the poles, you can see there's a distinct thorny head, which will pop out and become the mac. Motility, if you're lucky, if they're trophozoites or something. Although sometimes, for instance, if you have a fresh schistosome, you'll see the myrcidium moving within the egg. If it's not being preserved in formalin, you'll actually see the myrcidium moving it within. Similarly, if you've got an older hookworm egg, say it's 24 hours old or something and hasn't been preserved, it will larvate and you will see those larvae crawling around within the egg. So then you know you've got something that's probably parasitic. And often there's a lot of space within the eggs and such like. So these are not perfect, but they're little things which you can start looking at. Now, let's have a look at some non-parasites. I cannot get this thing here to move forward. Could I get you to move the slide forward for me, please? Thank you. Okay, top left, there's a bit of plant hair. Why is that a bit of plant hair? Now, why is that not a parasite? I mean, it looks like a worm, doesn't it? It's sort of wormy shaped. So let's have a look at our little rules here, which we can use. Well, if we measured it, it probably would be the wrong size. It would be quite large, actually. It's sort of symmetrical. It's got defined borders. But it hasn't got any distinct organelles in it, and that's the key. When you see a larva, there will be a gut, there will be an esophagus, there'll often be a buccal cavity, etc. So you look at that and you go, that's a plant hair. To the right, there's just some sort of red acid fast staining thing in a cryptosporidium stain. Again, although it's, you know, pretty round, it's symmetrical, we might measure it. It might even be between 6 and 8 micrometers, which is about the right size for cryptosporidium, but it doesn't have any organelles. When you see a true crypto, you can see the sporozoites within them. If you look carefully, you'll see the sporozoites within, and you don't see it there. Now, in the middle left, that looks like an entamoeba, doesn't it? Hands up who thinks that's an entamoeba. Oh, you all know I'm tricky, right? But look, the nucleus looks a bit entamoeba-like, doesn't it? It's got a nice central karyosome and a nice, you know, evenly defined, you know, sort of chromatin around the edges. Actually, that's a pycnotic macrophage. And when they go pycnotic in feces, they often look like that. They often look in a, that's an iron hematoxylin stain. They can look a lot like an entamoeba nucleus. Why do we know this is not an entamoeba or maybe a bit of a funny looking entamoeba? Because it doesn't have any defined borders. You know, when you see an entamoeba cyst, it has a distinct cyst wall. There is no distinct cyst wall here. And something I want to point out, when you do see entamoebas in stains, they generally shrink. If you want to measure the size, you should measure the outer part of the shrinkage. So, you know, there's that little bit of ghosting within. Measure from that because they've shrunk. They've actually got smaller. So the correct size is the original shape that they took up when they've shrunken. So measure the full distance there. Then we've got a nice little pollen grain there. How come it's not a tenia egg or something like that? That's actually a little bit of a confusing one. But once again, it hasn't got any distinct organelles. If you move through the fine planes of focus, you won't see any hooklets or anything like that. And then some more pollen grains down the bottom. Quite thick walls on them. And if you look, the edges aren't really perfectly defined, right? They're not like perfectly round. With parasites, it's generally like perfectly round. So the best advice I ever got given was, if you're not sure it's a parasite, it's probably not, right? that's probably the best bit of advice I've ever been given in parasitology. If you're not sure, it's probably not, because real parasites jump out at you. You can see there's something quite distinct about that, and it's not just a bit of crap. There's something really, you know, they're well-defined, and they have organelles and things like that. If we could move to the next slide, please. Thank you. Right, here's some more fake parasites. Up the top left is a really funny looking, it's probably a pollen grain or something like that. To the right, there's another pycnotic macrophage pretending to be a dientamoeba. Now, in the middle there, they really look like parasite eggs, don't they? Who here thinks that those are eggs? I think they're eggs. Who thinks there's a parasite egg in the middle there? I think there's a parasite egg. In the, on the right at the bottom, that's a hookworm egg. And right next to it, there's something which looks like a hookworm egg, only it's a whole lot bigger. It's been taking steroids or something like that. It's actually a mite egg. That's a mite egg. And you see these often, you know, when people are eating food out of their garden and things like that, they can consume mites with the leaves. And so you end up, you know, they pass the eggs of the mites. The mites have eggs, the eggs pass out the other end. Now, the one on the left is also a mite egg, and it's a shame I can't really point easily, but if you look really carefully at the bottom right of that egg, you'll see there's a bit of a leg developing. So one of the things about mite eggs is they actually develop into insects within the egg, right? So you start to see legs and antennae and things like that developing. They're generally a lot bigger as well. You know, they're normally 150 micrometers or something like that. Not all of them, but they're distinctly not hookworm. The other thing which is helpful is, see how the hookworm has a bit of space? It has the morula and then there's a space. You don't get that with mite eggs. They fill the whole egg. So mite eggs, you know, you can come across. The bottom left, who here thinks that's a parasite? The bottom left. I'll give you a hint. Now, I've said this about feces. This is actually in a bronchoalveolar lavage. Okay, it's swimming. It's motile. Who thinks it's a parasite? I can't trick you. I think if I were going to write it up, I'd call it a Lophomonas, a cockroach parasite, which has become very popular these days. And there's all these papers about Lophomonas infection in people's bronchoalveolar, specifically turning up in bronchoalveolar lavages. But it's not. It's a bronchial epithelial cell, and it's got cilia, right? And seriously, there's a whole, like, package of literature out there. There's about 25 or 30 papers or something, aren't there, Abhishek? We've been looking at this, on Lophomonas infections in people, and they're not. They're just bronchoalveolar lavages. Bronchial epithelial cells, which have been identified as this similar-looking cockroach parasite. So strange things happen because, you know, they're motile and they swim, and well, they don't swim, but they do this, you know, and they sort of think, oh, it's alive, it must be a parasite. The bottom right, you get these things often brought in by people from their toilets, and they'll bring in these worms and they'll say, this is in the toilet and I passed it. Or one of them, somebody vomited, and they said they vomited these up and sent them to me with their vomit, bit of nice, into the toilet, that is, you know. And those that's an insect larva. That one, it's a cycoded, so drain fly larva. I remember when I was living in Queensland going on holiday for 2 weeks, and I came back and I had mosquito larvae growing in my toilet bowl because I hadn't flushed the toilet bowl and I'd left the seat up, you know, which probably get me in trouble with a girlfriend or something. But, you know, so that happens. And what happens is people come along and there are some cycoded larvae, drain fly larvae or mosquito larvae or something in their toilet bowl. And they defecate. They don't look before they defecate. They defecate and then they see these live things swimming around in their toilet, or they vomit into it if they've perhaps been out and eaten too many bad kebabs. And they find these things swimming around. And they decide that they've obviously vomited this up or they've passed this. And then they take it into you. Which leads us into a whole thing about delusional parasitosis, which you, hands up, who's come across a few cases of those in the past. If you get into parasitology, they find you. They find you. And look, you know, most of them have what we call formication, where they have the delusion that they've got bugs under their skin. Some of them think they've got intestinal parasites. And, you know, there's a few things I'd say about these people. The first one is be kind, because they are genuinely sick. You know, a lot of them, the funny thing about delusional parasitosis is many of them are, not all, but many of them are otherwise relatively normal. It's just they have this fixed delusion. They are, for them, this is real. For them, this is real. It can be very hard to work with, I believe, for the clinicians who have to deal with it. If you can somehow get them towards a psychiatrist and get them onto, I believe they respond very well to antipsychotics, but this is outside of my area. But, you know, do be aware that these are real people who have a genuine illness, because there's a habit of making fun of them. And, you know, it can be funny, but be kind. Be aware that they are genuinely sick. The second thing which I'd say about this is investigate. Make sure that they don't have a parasite, because it does happen. So I've got a few stories about this which I could tell you. I'll tell you one of them. There are many. There was a friend of mine in Austria who runs the Helmuth Reference Lab in Austria. This woman came in and she said to her doctor, you know, I've got a parasite crawling under my face and it's itchy all the time. And of course, the doctor sent her off for psychiatric evaluations, et cetera. And, she got the diagnosis with delusional parasitosis. Well, eventually it got so bad that she ripped this thing out of her face. She literally tore a bit of her face out because it was so itchy and awful, and she thought there was a parasite in there. She took it to a doctor who wisely put it into formalin and sent it off for histology. And in the histology, they found a zoonotic Oncocerca. So she had a strange fox Oncocerca that had gone in, you know, wrong host, gone under the face and was crawling around under her face. So it does actually happen. You know, some of these people genuinely have a parasite or something weird. So I think it is important to at least do some investigation first. Though, I mean, clinicians like Alistair and such like will probably say, you know, some of them, I gather, it's pretty obvious, but it's still worth, you know, just do some investigation. They may be just a slightly eccentric person who also has a parasite, or they may be someone who's got delusional parasitosis, but it's important not to totally disregard them before you've done any investigation. Moving on to the next slide, whilst we're talking about things in toilets, and I've only got 6 minutes left, so I'd better rush. If we could go to the next slide, please. Thanks. Right, here's some stuff coming out of toilets, stuff coming out of diapers, etc. Who here thinks the ones on the left are a parasite? I think the ones on the left are a parasite. These are Ascaris lumbricoides being passed. The first one's in a toilet bowl in Mississippi. The first one's in a diaper from a child in Mississippi. The second one was passed by someone in southwest Western Australia. Their travel history was they'd been to Bali 30 years previously. And Ascaris only lives for 3 years. So how did they get Ascaris? And in Mississippi, I've done a bit of work on surveillance for parasites in Mississippi. It's not very common. It's not like it's transmitting. How did they get Ascaris? Particularly in southwest Western Australia. And it is an Ascaris. The first question I asked on both of them is, do they have anything to do with pigs? And one of them was a pig farmer, the West Australian, and the child, they had backyard pigs. So pigs carry Ascaris lumbricoides, and they carry Ascaris lumbricoides in Australia, and you can get infected with that Ascaris randomly. So it does occasionally happen if you're exposed to Ascaris from pigs. And there have been two cases in Tasmania as well, which John Goldschmidt diagnosed in the 70s. So just because it doesn't make sense, you need to think a little bit further, investigate further. Sometimes it starts to make sense. The ones on the right, there's an Ascaris in a toilet bowl on the right. The one in the middle is an earthworm. And this happens as well. People, particularly if they've got cracks in the pipes, earthworms get in. The earthworm ends up in the bowl. They go to the toilet. They find the earthworm. They bring it in and say, I passed this worm. Now, when you look at earthworms carefully under a microscope, they have setae, these little hairs along them. No human parasite has that. It's pretty distinct that they're earthworms. But just be aware, people bringing in earthworms from their toilet bowl is not actually that uncommon. If we go to the next slide. Now, here's an interesting thing. These slides, the pictures, most of them are from the Solomon Islands. One of them is from a refugee in Hobart. And you can see it's modified acid fast positive, this thing. Who thinks that's a parasite egg? It's a parasite egg. And it's about 120 micrometers long. Some of them are asymmetric. They've got a bit of a jelly bean shape. Some of them are straight. 90 to about 120. I mean, at the 90 range, you might worry, could it be Trichostrongylus? It looks almost a little bit like that. That's a ruminant parasite that very occasionally infects humans. But it's not quite right. You can see it's got those little air sacs at each side. And what this is it's a plant parasite. It's not a human parasite. It's a plant parasite. It's Meloidogyne species. It used to be called Heterodera species. This is a root knot nematode. So it infects root vegetables. And it was actually quite common when we were doing surveys in a remote part of the Solomon Islands because they eat a lot of taro and sweet potato and things like that, and they sometimes eat it raw. And then they pass the eggs. It's just passing through. But you can come across this in someone's feces, and you do come across it sometimes, and it looks like a parasite. It can be hard to determine. So how do you work that out? Well, size first and foremost, and then have a look at shapes and get into your books, get into atlases and things, have atlases, get excited about parasitology, you know, and you'll just know stuff. If we can pass on to the next slide, thanks. Sometimes the parasites don't read the textbooks. So here are, who thinks there are parasite eggs here? There are parasite eggs everywhere here. They're all parasite eggs. On the left, those are all Ascaris lumbricoides eggs, but they're doing strange things. One of them is a double yoker. It has, you know, two morulae in it, and around it are normal Ascaris lumbricoides eggs. That's in a cage of cats. The other one's just a weird shape. We don't know why. Maybe none of these people had antelmintics. It's not that. Maybe the worms are old. Maybe they're young. Maybe it's got to do with crowding in the gut. A lot of these people had heavy infections. We don't know, but sometimes they don't read the textbook. Sometimes they do strange things. In amongst them were a whole lot of normal eggs, though. So you should be able to determine. You can see there's a lovely trichurus there. Looks like a love heart. I just put it in there because I think it's romantic. And then there's a schistosoma mansoni with two spines. So strange things happen. Okay. Next slide. Now, this is something got sent to me from India, and it's slightly political, so I can't tell you where it came from in India or who sent it to me, but it was sent to us when I was at CDC from India. And who thinks there's a parasite egg there? This was in three people from a part of India. Three different people had these. I think it's a parasite egg. It's 120 micrometers. I think it's a parasite egg. Yep. Yep, it's a parasite egg. It's a schistosome. It's clearly a schistosome. This would have been unpreserved, so you would have seen the myrcidium moving within it, so that would have given it away. It's a terminal spine schistosome. Who here thinks it's schistosoma hematobium? Yep, good answer. It's not. The only terminal spine schistosome of humans I ever got taught about was hematobium. We can click to the next bit. Does it look like that? What do you do when you get something like this? I mean, what do you do? This got sent to us, and I was like, well, I don't know what this is, but I can tell it's a schistosome. So how do you investigate this? Well, what I did was I said, this is from India. It's clearly not any human schistosome I know about, so maybe it's an animal one. So I started reading, what are all the schistosomes of animals in India? And there are about 12 of them, 13, I think it was. And I went through and found out, because every single parasite somewhere, way back in the olden days, someone wrote a paper where they described its morphology. They had to do that to describe the parasite. So I went and got those papers on every one of these parasites that was in rats and cows and pigs. And I found this picture. And doesn't that look good? If we can, this is the paper from 1926 by Chandler, a new schistosome infection of man with notes on other human fluke infections in India. This is Schistosoma incognitum and the second only case reported in humans, though never really properly reported because there's all sorts of political issues about us publishing it. But it is real, and it's actually a parasite of dogs, pigs, and rats, but very occasionally it can cause zoonotic human infection. So, you know, just because it looks weird doesn't mean you should ignore it. Maybe it's something just really, really weird. Next slide. Here's something. Who thinks there's a parasite here? I think there's a parasite here. This is a weird looking thing. It's about the size of a Giardia cyst, but it's not a Giardia cyst. I always think it looks a bit like one of those gray aliens from the movies, the face, you know, of a gray. Now, this I found in the feces of, when I was doing a survey of food sellers in the Gambia in West Africa, just there, what they had parasite-wise, and we found these things, quite a lot of them actually. I've still got them preserved. And this person is genuinely infected with this parasite. It's only transient. The infection only lasts a few weeks. And we think it's asymptomatic, but no one really knows. No one's looked into it. So you've got to work out what that is. Well, if we can go to the next picture. Yep, I'd seen this once before. Here's a slide from John Goldschmidt from a workshop he did back in the early 2000s. There's a cyst of an entamoeba, and there's something looks very like ours. And this is a Myxozoan oocyst. It's a fish coccidium, which can, if you eat raw fish, it can infect you. And you'll pass the oocysts for a couple of weeks, and then it just goes away, or a week or two. And it's probably more common than we realize. People just overlook it. How do I know about that? Well, just because I attended workshops like this and paid attention. So somewhere I went, I've seen that somewhere before. And I sent photos to John, and he said, yep, that's exactly what it is. If we can go to the next slide. This has happened in Australia before. Here's a report from Sullivan Nicolaides Pathology from the 90s, back when we had time to write papers about case reports. And there were three cases of myxozoan in humans in the Brisbane area. So, you know, once again, if you don't know, if you think it might be a parasite, I mean, it fits that thing of being symmetrical and, you know, just take some photographs, measure it, et cetera, and send it off to someone. Let's have a look at the next slide, shall we? That's just the paper if you want to read it on that case. Next slide. Oh, this got sent to me by Bobby Pritt at the Mayo Clinic. And she said, look, this is a funny looking thing. It's quite large. It's about 11 millimetres. So, no, it was 11 millimetres? Can't remember. Anyway, it's quite large. It's about the size of a free-living strongyloides. And she wanted to know, is it a free-living strongyloides? And it's just a bit broken down. It came from an old lady, a 90-year-old lady in Louisiana. And there's some pictures which I drew of free-living strongyloides, because when I'm bored, I draw pictures of parasites. And you can see it's not, it's not, it's, it's, I had difficulty with this. I can tell you from the size and everything, it's definitely not any human parasite. And even the really weird free-living things like turnidens and such like that you haven't heard of, it's not one of them, or Diplocapta. It's probably a Rhabdius. We can go to the next slide. This is a free-living nematode in the soil. She's 90. She's probably ingested it with some vegetables and things like that. She's probably a bit achlorhydric and it's just passing through. So that's what I think it is. It does fit actually morphologically quite well with that. So important to think about these things. And quite often it's just things passing through, particularly as people get more and more into organics and growing their own veggies. So we'll just go to the next slide. If you really want to investigate, if you think something's strange, you can do a bit of fecal archaeology. You treat them and you collect their feces for 24 to 48 hours, and then you start sifting with different grades of sift until you find the adult worms that they're passing. And if you've given them praziquantel, the adults will be a bit blustered up, but you can still probably pull one out. So you can do that if you get excited. I've done that. It's a whole lot of fun. And then next slide, there's some information. If anyone wants, I can email this to you. Just some ideas of how to get better at this. You know, go and have a look at Bobby Fritz's blog. It's called Crazy, Dreadful, Wonderful Parasites. And every week she has a new parasite that she puts up and you can work out what it is. Get engaged. Go along to talks like this. Go to conferences. Engage with, if you're interested in parasites, talk to us because we want to know who's interested in parasites. You know, recently there was a job at CDC and I tried to get Australians who might want to apply for it. They said, you got any mates who want to apply? And I only knew one person who I thought might be interested. Any of you want one? Well, you need to talk to us and we'll tell you about things like this. So, you know, get involved. Last slide. Finally, anyone who's got any issues, email me. And Harsha, if you have a weird parasite, he's got a group, including myself, that we send things around. I apologize about going over time. Thank you.